Hello, we're back with Novel London this evening with our featured authors Dan Holloway and Rohan Quine. And I'm going to kick off with the Q&A now. First of all, we're going to have some questions for both of the authors about the common themes between Dan's Kill Land and Rohan's The Beasts of Electra Drive. And then we're going to dig into each of the novels in a little more detail. Are you falling off there?
I'm falling off. I'm doing my boy zone thing. So we're standing up at the key change.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. Mary Carr wrote, "You'll need both sides of yourselves, the beautiful and the beastly, to hold a reader's attention." I wonder if you'd both like to talk about, Rohan first perhaps, about how you employ that in your novel.
To make the most interesting and vibrant use of our small amount of time while we're here surely involves not editing out the dark stuff. I mean, it sounds very simple when you put it like that, but there is often a terror of truly engaging with the dark stuff, and if you are prepared to truly engage with the dark stuff, then that doesn't necessarily mean to say you need to delve down into it obsessively. It means that there is then a resonance, one hopes, a resonance to whatever you say that takes its presence partly from a preparedness to go anywhere. Just like if somebody's really interesting, then you can even talk about the weather with them and it's not boring. But if someone can only talk about the weather and that's all they can talk about, of course that's not very interesting at all. You know, what I'm saying is that there are resonances, and that I think can apply to writing as well.
Do you mean a short time in life or a short time in this bookshop?
I meant in life.
Yeah, but both would apply.
They would.
As someone who's absolutely fascinated with the weather, I would be quite happy to spend an evening talking with someone who could only talk about the weather.
Okay.
Because they could probably talk about it very interestingly. I think it's a really weird dichotomy, though, isn't it? The way you talk about the beautiful and the beastly, as though they're two completely different things. And I'm not sure why we have this dichotomy, why we don't just say there is this stuff, there is the ooze and swarm, as Michael Chabon so beautifully put it and you so beautifully rendered it. And that the ooze and swarm can be anything we want it to be, and it can be both beautiful and beastly at the same time. But the key is to engage with everything about life and not to leave anything out, and then that will just be what it is. I don't think I would draw the distinction between the two, because the beastly can often be beautiful and the beautiful can be beastly and various other cliches. But basically, like Rohan was saying, if you try and hide life from yourself, then, or try and censor or edit or take one side or present things in a one-sided way, that's when you get into trouble. But just sort of laying it out there in all its mess, because, like, yes, our time here is too short to do otherwise. I'm also distracted. Sorry, I'm talking about the time here. I'm distracted because everyone,
the food's
come out. Everyone who's watching, the food's come out, and it looks absolutely delicious. And we're sitting here with no food and no drink.
We can aspire.
We can aspire to the tostadas. Yes.
They smell delicious. Yes. It strikes me that what else the two books have in common is that your anti-heroes, I'm going to call them, both wreak some kind of Old Testament-style vengeance. And I'm wondering with that, is there a point at which, now coming on from Dan's point about, you know, why making the distinction, the question that I wrote, is there a point at which the good guy becomes the bad guy? But it's really about, are there any boundaries that you're not, that you wouldn't let your characters, or any lines that you wouldn't let your characters cross? To Dan, I think, first, could follow up on your last one.
Yes, well, I have a very short answer to that, is yes, I will never let my characters harm animals, and that's a really stupid and really sentimental and really twee, but they can do anything, literally anything else, but they will never harm animals. So that's the banal answer. I don't like the distinction between heroes and villains and anti-heroes and heroes, and I think there aren't enough sympathetic characters who do really unpleasant things, and I think we're very uncomfortable with because we tend to associate really unpleasant with really bad, and I don't think they're necessarily the same thing. And I think the books come out at a very bad time for revenge, because obviously with what's happening in America, there's a lot of talk about bullying and revenge that really makes the conversation rather messy. But what I wanted to get us into is what we would, is this thing about the room with no windows. What would you do if you had 5 minutes alone with someone in a room with no windows? And really ask ourselves that question, and could we guarantee our actions and vouchsafe our actions? And if we did the things we imagine we'd do, does that make us a bad person or not? Does it make us a good person? What would we actually do?
Who's the person in this scenario?
Well, it's the person who has hurt you and the ones you love more than anything, and has rendered, like you're saying about life being so short, who has made the one brief, fleeting opportunity we had at anything meaningful or enjoyable, has rendered that impossible. So that you know your life from this point on has no meaning, no purpose, no hope of joy, no hope of redemption. The person who brought that about, what would you do if you were alone with them in a room?
I'd just like to point out that this room has no windows. I won't leave you alone with him.
Unless the person here who wrote that review on Goodreads, then you've got nothing to worry about.
To you then?
Well, there are two murders, without any spoilers here, there are two murders in The Beasts of Electra Drive, and they are essentially murders of people that have committed the crime. Essentially, it's the crime of being tabloid and of inflicting a tabloid ugliness on the world, a tabloid style ugliness on the world, at a very large scale. So I think it's extremely justified to make them suffer. Because one of the things I enormously hate for being ugly, not visually, it doesn't matter, ugly in the sense of bringing everybody down, that's ugly, bringing down all our potentials, it's that tabloid mindset. Literally speaking, the Sun, the Mail, etc., etc., but I'm actually thinking sort of more widely than that, obviously, that sort of twist of mind or instinct of mind. However, where I wouldn't go is actually physical torture. It won't spoil anything to say that those two murders, although they are inhabited from within the murderer in each case, and rather luxuriantly so, nonetheless are murders that do not glory in causing physical pain. So I don't want to go there. This is just for me. For me, that's not a rich, physical torture is not a rich thing for me to think about or display.
There's a whole chapter of...
Yeah. I know that's rather different in there. So if you opt that sort of thing, then look for that, at least the end of it. But you won't find that in mine. You'll find when push comes to shove, a slight minimisation in these two murders of suffering of the individuals.
Is there a reason, I'm intrigued, because... This is going back, we'll come on to the editing process, but I'm intrigued as to why you pull back, because I know the one thing you don't like doing is pulling back. Was it an aesthetic thing? Was it a moral thing? Was it just that you didn't feel it was right for the book? Or was there some
It derives from the fact that, to my mind, physical pain in humans, and indeed other animals as well, is actually one of the biggest design flaws in this scenario that we have here called being alive. It's one of the two or three main things, main design flaws that prevent me, ultimately, from holding an overall respect for the design of this sentient life we've been given. It's one of the things that prevents me from respecting that design as an all-in, overall proposition. And to be more precise, it's not physical pain in general that prevents my respect. It is the unimaginably deep chasms of extreme pain that some people and animals fall into, whose extremity of pain is just so unimaginably deep that it could only ever bear only a grotesquely disproportionate relation to any sort of justice or anything that might be deserved, in quotes. And to be clear, I mean, I respect the individuals, it's the subjecting to them to this sort of cloddishly, randomly allocated array of chasms of pain that strike certain people. That's the basis of it.
It's a very Dostoevskian view, basically. It's Brothers Karamazov, isn't it? It's the the you can't justify God in the face of the extreme suffering of innocence.
I suppose, and it's fairly straightforward, but to me its straightforwardness in no way diminishes the truth it has for me as something that...
I agree with you entirely, but that I think that's why I want to show it. I want to show it because I agree with you.
Okay. That this happens and it shouldn't.
This happens and it shouldn't. But it does happen, and it happens all over the place, and we need to somehow find a way of coming to terms with it. And the way of coming to terms with it, we find, can't be God for the Dostoevsky reason.
Yes.
So what do we do? How do we face this?
I should state that it's only extremes of physical pain I'm talking about here. So I know that one of the topics that you've often dealt with is extremes of pain that are not necessarily physical. I mean, extremes of mental illness in your campaigning that you've addressed, and elsewhere in your fiction and so forth. It's not all about physical. It's not all about the physical stuff that happens in that room at the end of Killland. I am just thinking about the physical stuff. So, for example, therefore, I do not spare my deserved victims in The Beasts of Electra Drive in other ways. I put them through the ringer, as you may perhaps have picked up, in terms of just terrifying the shit out of them and anguish and so forth. Some of the physical stuff. I'm glad somebody finds that very funny. It is quite funny, really, isn't it? Yeah.
So, in summing up, marginally safer in the room with no windows with Rohan than Dan.
Yeah.
Only marginally. You're not convinced. You're not convinced.
I wouldn't go with either of us.
Best off with Jane.
What you'd actually end up is listening to us babbling about Dostoevsky and philosophy. then you really would be stuck.
There is a possibility.
Do we have a question from the audience?
But Ron, that view you've just expressed, are you not rather reductionist, reducing characters into good and bad? Surely the point that literature and fiction, the reason that fiction is so valuable is because it is able to show characters who...
Oh, I agree, but the question related to this particularly narrow concern of meeting out something that we wouldn't go to. This whole debate only occupies about 2% of what this novel deals with, but because the question asked where would you not go, that's where I would not go.
Yes, but what I was meaning was that you the victims in that you've expressed very clearly are unequivocally...
No, they're bad. Complicated. Two of them come over to the side of light, as I would call it, although to call it the side of light is also reductive.
Right.
You haven't done a deal with them. They won't have the extreme pain if they come over to the right side.
No, it's nothing that cut and dried. So there are four antagonists that I privately think of as antagonists in my book because I was so buried in the construction of the book. So, I would think in those terms. But one of them is that girl whom I described as a fun-loving, cool party girl called Kelly Candy. I referred to her. She's nice, she's fun, you'd like to drink with her, she's all right. But she happens to be one of my antagonists because of certain twists of mind. And indeed, it's because she's a nice, fun, cool person that I mean, I cast her as that because I also wanted to complicate her by showing that even in nice, cool, fun people, there are these other aspects that are not normally examined, especially by people who don't examine them.
She's not the one that's just been appointed to head the CIA.
I don't know. I can't remember who that is. There is a woman who's just been appointed.
Yeah, she was a torturer.
Was she? Oh, yeah. God. Something to do with South America, wasn't it?
Black site in Thailand.
That's right. Rings a bell. Yeah,
but
yeah,
she sounds
yeah.
as if she's quite fun-loving. And
yeah, absolutely. This is it. So this is an example. So no, it's not reductionist, no.
Okay.
Glad to say.
Can I ask then, both of these books touch on issues that I feel are quite close to you. Dan's mentioned that already. How much of your DNA feels wrapped up in this book? Dan, if I can come to you on that first.
All of it completely. I'm not a life and art separate person. Everything goes into the fiction. In a sort of a write what you know kind of way. I do get into trouble sometimes. People say, with one of my other books, the comments I used to get was, Well, I used to get people backing away from me and then saying, are you sure your family know about this? But yes, no, the issues are issues I feel are important. There's mental health, self-harm, suicide come up, bullying, revenge, but also what the nature of ties, the ties that we have, the communities that we have. I think that's the most important thing in this. I think I started writing it while David Cameron was still Prime Minister. So the idea of the big society was still something that was going around, and that was one of my absolute, in terms of reductionism, my absolute passionate hatreds. this notion of community as being something that's very reduced to these other people who are physically around you, and I was wanting to try and explore the ideas of what could be the ties between a community. And in the book we have the ties between a community are the ties of pain and a shared pain and shared suffering. And that's where the influence of Bosnia comes in. If anyone knows the book Ministry of Pain by Dubravka Ugrešić, which is an amazing book about the Serbian and Croatian communities who have fled. They fled the former Yugoslavia and they come together in a university in Holland. And it starts off, they have discussions about the subtle ways that they use words ever so slightly differently. I can see someone in the audience knows the book. It's an absolutely remarkable book. Yeah. But they have this common history, even though they were on different sides, even though people they know were murdering each other. There is this common history of pain and devastation and trying to rebuild something from scratch. That ties them together in a way they can't quite communicate. And the fact they can't communicate it verbally gets them into trouble with their actions from time to time. But it's still something that they have that no one else shares with them. And that sort of idea of community is something I really wanted to explore through this. So yes, that's
it's interesting because it's sort of the definition of community is the thing that keeps you apart from other people when you're talking about it in terms that other people can't relate to.
Yes, it's the thing that other people can't relate to rather than the thing that you necessarily would choose each other's company for.
Yes. Okay. I see that. Can you remember the question?
It's to do with DNA.
Yes! Yes.
Well, one answer is that at the simplest level, these beasts, these eponymous beasts of Electra Drive, are actually kind of externalizations of my protagonist, and therefore to a large extent externalizations of me. So to that extent, I'm totally wrapped up in it. And creating those games that he creates in the novel is very related to my creating the other titles of mine, Flyers for Which Are Lying Around, which have the same names as the games that my protagonist of this novel creates. So there's a metafictional thing going on here. I don't explain how these very analogue works of literary prose could possibly be played as a game in The Beast of Electra Drive, but that's, I don't need to explain, they're just presented as such. So yes, totally me wrapped up, DNA-wise, in complex ways.
I think actually, because of the way the conversation's moving forward, I'm going to move on to The Beast of Electra Drive now, because you're probably holding back answering a question that I had, is that could you explain exactly who or what the beasts are?
Sure, they are externalizations of my protagonist, and their origins are evoked in these intense creation cycles. Each beast, there are six or seven beasts, each of them has this intense creation cycle, and those creation cycle chapters alternate with more narrative, readable, consumable kinds of external life kind of chapters, but they're alternating with intensely uncompromising, more poetic stuff, which is their creation cycle things. And the second and third of the two chapters you heard tonight are examples of those creation cycle chapters. The first was chapter one, because we have to read out chapter one here. That's not this. But the other two, that dark stuff in the nightclub, that's pure creation cycle stuff. It was from a very dark beast called Scorpio, who has a different name, Angel, in another couple of the titles of mine, same character, different gender in one of them. And the third I read out was also a much more sort of pastoral, classical, calm, slightly pessimistic, and measured sort of character called Kim. So coming back to the beasts, yes, they are the origins of the same characters in the other titles. And I'll say one more thing about them. If you wanted to suggest topical aspects of them, this is totally optional, but if you wanted to, you could say that they might anticipate the fun that we'll all have in externalizing aspects of ourselves through AI coming up soon. I didn't write them with that in mind at all, and that sounds very sci-fi, and this isn't quite sci-fi, but really down the turnpike for real, there is coming the technology, as you may have read about in different ways. We can't quite predict how it's going to happen, but it will happen that we'll be able to externalize as avatars, essentially. You know, we've already got, you know, rudimentary avatars. We'll have much, much, much richer avatars, the reverse of you know, VR, etc., etc. So you could view them as a foretaste of that.
It's interesting you mentioned sci-fi there, because Rohan's had some initial reviews of his book, and I wouldn't think of it as fitting into a sci-fi genre, but some of your reviewers have suggested.
Interesting, yeah, which is so cool. I think of it as literary fiction and a touch of magical realism and a dusting of horror, but I'm very happy to be branded with whatever.
I think it's genre-breaking fiction, isn't it?
Pushing genre-bending, yes, there. Exactly. And I suspect that a reader of sci-fi who's well-read in sci-fi, which I am not, by the way, I wish I were, I wish I could claim that, but I can't claim that I'm well-read in sci-fi, would probably, I'm guessing here, maybe doing myself down, but they would probably read this and say, you know, not quite as original as that literary fiction reviewer over there thinks it is, because, you know, I've read a bunch of sci-fi that is more sort of referential of other sci-fi that's been written in the past. You know, I would sort of feel like I didn't know my sci-fi background if I were deliberately setting out to write sci-fi. I'd secretly read a bunch of it before I claimed to be writing sci-fi.
That's the wrong way to do it.
Well, I like that. Thank you. So in that case, I'm absolutely fine. Yes, I've been given the sanction here.
We had this conversation endlessly in various cafes.
That's true.
About where you fitted.
So, it's, you know, it can put its sci-fi hat on and wear its sci-fi credentials if it wants to.
The other thing that comes with these creation cycles is there is a very religious element to it. There's a very magical incantatory element to it, and that's something I tried to play up in the editing. That it feels like incantation cycles, and it's reminiscent of ideas like the golem and these sort of
Mayrink
being created from the dust.
Okay.
And
it's
there is a religious element and a ritualistic element to these beasts, as it
were. It's lovely that you were on board with the repetition from the beginning, because I can freely admit that in a number of the reviews or reactions to it that I've so far had, and let's remember it's not published yet, technically, this publication date is meant to be the 11th of this month, but so far, there's about six or seven advanced reviews, and one or two of them, not the bits I quote, but elsewhere in the reviews, say, you know, all kinds of good things, but there was a bit of repetition, and I didn't know why he was doing that, essentially. Well, you know, guess what? It was deliberate. And there was this incantatory thing that Dan is mentioning. You mentioned the beginning of Genesis, where, and on the seventh day, blah, 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 it carries on.
Yes, the repetitious language.
Repetition. Touch of that going on, and this is another, this is an example too that I was thinking of. There was in the Just So stories by Rudyard Kipling, then came Dingo, Yellow Dog Dingo, cutting through the salt pans, and not only is there that rhythm, but it carries on. It's prose, but it carries on, and there is a sort of authentic, atavistic feeling of...
I think I would rather wear my Mr. Kipling influence on my sleeve than my Rudyard Kipling.
Oh, yes. Mr. Kipling's exceedingly good stories, yes.
I should probably just point out for anyone who's joined us late, that Dan was also Rohan's editor on the Beasts of Electra Drive, which is why he can jump into the discussion.
And let me say, he was editor of Jane's novel too, whose cover, by the way, we haven't talked about Jane because there we are, but Jane's cover coming out very soon is above me on my left, Smash All the Windows. And there's, of course, our two covers. But yes, Dan edits developmental editing, you know, which is the difficult stuff. That's the intelligent stuff.
It's really cool stuff.
It's the cool stuff.
You get to sit in a cafe in Soho and talk about Blade Runner for 2 hours.
We didn't sit in a cafe.
Which is really cool.
We didn't sit in a cafe. I just got instructions to watch the opening scene from The Player. And something else from Silence of the Lambs. As this is the breadth of his cultural reference points when you're editing fiction.
Silence of the Lambs, moral guidance like that, we enjoy it.
Yes, absolutely. So back to Jaymi. In the first chapter, I think we heard him spelling out one of his mission statement as a teenager still, but it was to mine truth, beauty and magic from the splendour and pain intertwined in the world's design. And I really sense that was your aim with the novel, really.
Yeah, it does execute a deep dive into the beauty and horror and mirth and complexities of our individual human quests to inhabit life as richly as possible. That's its grand ambition anyway. And to celebrate the idiosyncratic parts of us, the unicorn qualities in us, the antagonist company, complicated by being appealing in some cases, but it's peopled by characters who are really very kind of Rupert Murdoch News International kind of characters, who would want to look at one, their first instinct on looking at anything unicorn-like would be to file that horn down, make another reassuring horse, regular horse, right? that sort of nervous cultural and social interpersonal reaction that I despise so much, that sort of nervous, we need to make this regular. Being somewhat irregular myself, and all of us are frankly somewhat irregular. Yes, completely lost my thread now. What was the question again?
that was a very good answer.
It was your mission statement for the novel. I think you covered it.
I covered it, probably.
I think you covered it, yes. Returning to the beasts, they were really initially a thing created out of beauty and light and everything, but you didn't start out with the process with Jaymi thinking that he might use the beasts as a vehicle for revenge, as it were. But when he becomes picked on or finds himself under attack, he actually sees that potential in them. Did you worry that you were sort of turning them into Frankenstein's monsters, as it were?
Not really. I mean, for one thing, within the story, he is attacked pretty close to, I mean, you know, within minutes of deciding the beauty. They kind of do arise at the same time. But in any case, let's face it, there's not much drama in a story where it's all lovey-dovey and nice and sunbeams and we want to just do right to the world. There's got to be a little bit of gorgeous, destructive, poisonous, sultry kind of quality, as well as, if that sums it up. But yeah, so of course you want the dark stuff, you want to flirt with something on the edge of things. So that covers it. Let me see, something, a richer aspect of it. He is specifically, in his specific mission, which is kind of a cultural mission, which bleeds into everything that causes, you know, because healing the culture of us that we live in will help to heal all of us and to, you know, heal's the wrong word, but I mean enrich, allow enrichment, allow deep tabloidization will be an act of love and beauty and rightness for all of us, frankly. So he's putting his beasts at the service of that greater mission, if you like. So of course they're going to have to engage in a fight, you know. No, to the extent that it's political with an incredibly small p, only because people think of the word political and they think of something less poetic than this. But to the extent that it is political, in this regard, culturally political, and perhaps emotionally political, this novel involves a fight. Because guess what? Politics almost by definition involves a struggle, a fight, doesn't it? Else it's not really politics. You're not really changing anything if you don't have to fight and struggle.
No, I'm quite uncomfortable with this bit of the book. The fact that you are creating these characters to do your bidding seems to me a very objectifying and are you justified in creating something simply to do your will? This seems to be exactly the same as the...
But was that... I don't think that was the original intent, was it? I don't think that was the reason for the creation. I sort of felt as if it was something that Jaymi saw the potential
For one thing, Jaymi's no saint. He's a human being. He's not meant to be a hero. He's a combination of hero and anti-hero, like all of us, I suppose. None of us is a saint, you know. We have to get by. We've only got certain resources, you know, et cetera, et cetera, so we can't all be saints. So that's one answer, you know. I mean, it's the one truth, I mean, one true fact about him and about most characters in most books, I would think, you know, they're not saints. But in a sense, this sort of begins to come back to Jane's earlier question about an Old Testament style vengeance, because you and I have each created characters who very expressly, very centrally, were created by us in order to visit some sort of justice, as we saw it, upon people who, as we see it, deserve such justice. So it's sort of similar. I just do it without physical torture.
I'm going to move this on to a slightly different subject, I think. You already touched on artificial intelligence, and in the 1980s, the psychologist and counterculture figure, Timothy Leary, he's the person who invented the phrase turn on, tune in, drop out. He became fascinated by computers and the internet and virtual reality, and saw, he was saying, predicting that they would become the LSD of the 90s. In your near future, I assume it's the near future, it may be an alternative present, instead of expanding hearts and minds and souls, Bang Dead, the name of the nasty big corporation, is trying to sort of constrict thinking, really, by appealing to the lowest common denominator. I assume that that Jaymi is closer to the Timothy Leary vision of the potential for...
In a sense, what Bang Dead Games is doing is sort of an aspect of what we're all subject to now and have to sort of live under the church roof of, which is the whole sort of social media thing and constantly being digitized and online and visible and evaluated and evaluating and all
you're
the rest of it.
You're talking to Facebook.
So I am. Yes, thank you. The irony of this. Hi. Said the author on Facebook. Yes, that's what Bang Dead Games is to some extent. To save time, I put it into one company, but really, it's the whole complex of, you know, factors that cause us to be in this direction and how it too easily devolves, you know, into something that wastes people's time and that cartoonizes everything and whatnot. But yes, moving to specifics, just ever so briskly at this point, it's probably of relevance to say what these beasts are. They have, as it were, different qualities. And again, it reduces them somewhat and simplifies them to summarize it thus. But it's nonetheless, from within, when you create something, you sort of have to have a main thing from which each beast agitates. There is one who is sort of essentially a spirit of vengeance on what deserves vengeance. Then, having created him, Jaymi feels that was a bit negative, a bit dark, a bit, you know, one-dimensional. So he proceeds, and here we start seeing there's a learning of him as a creator throughout the whole thing. So there's a part of his journey is that he has a journey as a creator of beasts, and then as an orchestrator of already incarnated beasts, because after each creation cycle for each one, he then incarnates them. So that's then a separate degree. He starts getting more sophisticated in how he causes them to run around and doing stuff in the real life. So there's, and not only that, they're also, most of the beasts are reacting to a particular news feed that Bang Dead Games has put out, a very reductive news feed. There's the gal score, the guy score, the trivia score, the art score, and the cozy score. And the gal score is that sort of public shaming and denigration, often only implicit, of certain women of certain kinds, or, you know, we see it in the schoolyard, but we also see it online. The guy score implicitly shames and denigrates certain men, you know, for not being manly enough or as a man should be or whatever. There's the trivia score is just, you can imagine, it's the ghastly trivialization of everything and the scaredness of intellect and this kind of toxic tabloid-flavored simplicity that we're told, again, by those tabloid influences. And the arts score is my taking aim, really, at the celebration of simple art as opposed to complex art. Because too often we see simple art very celebrated indeed, and the complex stuff less so. And finally, the cosy score really is just sort of these soggy memes of cod psychology and cat videos and all you need is love memes, etc., which sell us all short, frankly. So in as a whistle-stop tour, those are central points, not the only points, but they are central points, among others, from which the beasts respectively agitate.
And we have all of this against the backdrop of LA.
Yes,
which is an area we're so familiar with, but is there any part of the landscape that you imagined, or is it a sort of love story to your recollection of your time there?
It's a love story in my recollection to my time there. I only lived there for two periods of 1 year each. My boyfriend sitting in the corner comes from LA, but by the time I met him, he too had left it. It's the kind of place many people leave. most people, not everyone, most people either in America either love New York or love LA, as you probably have heard. They are very different, as I'm sure you know. I basically am a total born New Yorker. I didn't like LA either time I was there, but that doesn't mean to say I wasn't fascinated with it. I was fascinated, among many other things, with the geography of it. And it's not a geographical novel, but I did take care to make the geography of it precise, partly as a kind of ironizable laying claim to a simulacrum of reality, which so many other aspects of the novel then undercut, showing in that Lynchian fashion with the swarm and the ewes that what seems like reality and what seems like this translatable, understandable interface between us is actually something of a construct. It can, even what you're hearing right now is kind of a construct, my best efforts to translate what's in here to what's out there in a way that doesn't, you know, be too obscure or too long-winded or whatever. This is a tiny example of that construct that we constantly, all of us, have to tangle with if we meet anybody else in our lives at all, if we're not a total hermit. Again, I've lost my throat, but LA, yes. So it's ironic. It was the geography, the accuracy of the geography. That's right. Of LA is an ironizable thing as an exemplar of reality that is in that Lynchian way questionable.
Does anybody else have a question for Rohan? If not, I shall.
I've got one.
Lovely.
Rohan, I'm kind of new to your books. And you did mention that some of the characters were kind of manifestations of previous versions of the same characters.
Yeah.
Is the order in which the books that have been written, is that the order in which you would like people to read them?
Not really. This is a prequel, and I wrote it most recently. There are two novels and there are four novellas, so there are six tales. And this is the second novel I've written, but it's a prequel to the other five tales. Altogether.
So it's an excellent entry point.
It is an entry point, yes. I haven't trumpeted it as number one, and I haven't put them all or caused them all to be put as a kind of numbered sequence or anything, because a bit like, you know, the Narnia books, for example, there is actually an order of them, but you don't really need to read them at the end of the day in the right order. You can read, even though The Magician's Nephew is a prequel to the rest. It was actually written afterwards, after some of the others, and you don't have to read it first. So it's a bit like this. This is my magician's nephew, if you like. This is the prequel to the rest. And I didn't know while I was writing the others that they were going to turn out to be revealed in this prequel as characters in a game, nor that the other tales, were going to be revealed as games, which is, of course, tricksy, because they're not games, they're bits of prose. So that's all I'll say, perhaps, for the moment on that.
Okay. So, just taking you back to Killland, then. Dan, I'm usually concerned when I'm the person asking the question that I don't give away too many spoilers for people who haven't read the rest of the book. But as you've mentioned already, you make no secret of what's actually going to happen. The tagline is, in the tunnels beneath Oxford, two women who have never met are about to commit a murder. It's hardly the approach for a conventional thriller, but again, your book is another novel that defies conventional categorisation, as it were.
Yes. The obvious answer to why I did it like that is a childhood growing up watching Columbo, because that is the best detective show ever, and never suffers from this problem of not knowing it doesn't matter that you know who done it and you know how they did it. So I think there's following, unraveling how you get somewhere is much more interesting than where you go. And there was actually a study done after I wrote the book, but relatively recently, into the psychology of reading, which showed that actually if you read the ending first, you get more out of the book, even if it's a surprise ending, because you get to appreciate more of how you get there. I love whodunits, but I also love knowing what's going to happen, and I love teasing out the journey of how you get there and what brings you to that place, because I think it's a much richer experience emotionally as you follow the characters, knowing where they're going, and therefore how you... It's Greek tragedy, basically.
It always used to be the construct of an essay as well, didn't it? You told people what you were going to tell them, you then told them, and then you summarised at the end what you were going to tell
them. That was what you were
told.
I never wrote those essays. And I always taught my students never to write those essays.
Just us, then.
All my teachers told me to do it, and it's absolutely the worst way you can write an essay. But apparently the best way you can give a PowerPoint. Also not true. But Greek tragedy is, as I say, is a classic example of this. You always know it's going to end up with someone alone on stage and everyone else dead. And the person who's alone on stage is going to end up despairing of all the people who are dead. And then a Tom Stoppard play is going to come out of it. But that doesn't... What's interesting about a Greek tragedy is the psychic journeys to get you there and the complexity of those journeys and the way characters change. And I think that's... Unless you know what you're going to change into, I don't think you can fully get the most out of the characters as they do the changing.
You sometimes read the end of novels first, when you read...
No, but I will usually read the Wikipedia.
Yeah.
There's plenty of novels where something from the end of the story
is right there at the start.
Yes. Yes. I mean, the first thing is discovery of a body.
Yeah.
And actually, halfway through, you've completely forgotten that, but it suddenly
comes back to you at the end.
Yes, and it's planting that seed
American,
there.
You know, the last chapter has been moved to the beginning. So first of all, we discover that the guy's dead, and then so the whole thing is about how and why it happened.
Yeah.
So it's a more sort of subtle
I think it's a richer version of the story,
It's quite a cinematic approach as well, isn't it? We do it in cinema, that we expect people to make the leap from, you know, one scene to another, but actually...
And actually, I mean, the film that stays with me most for some reason, even though it's not a particularly good film, but it was one of the first I watched when I was a student, was Goodfellas. And the thing I remember about that was it's one of those films that starts halfway through. The opening scene is the scene of them opening the boot of the car, and there's the dead guy in there. And then you spend the next hour and a half getting back to that scene. And that struck me at the time as being really, really effective way of storytelling, because everything you watch from that moment on, you're watching through that lens of how did I get, how on earth did we get to this place? And that's what I think what I wanted to do.
Yes. I want to talk about Cassie, who seems very much alone, despite the fact that she surrounds herself with like-minded people, and really to ask you whether you think that this aloneness, or the sense of being alone, is very much part of the human condition.
Part of the human condition?
Part
of my condition. I don't know. This is part of the problem of having a long history of having a long history of mental ill health and being slightly neurodivergent is I know my experiences are very much atypical. But it's my experience to experience myself as being completely alone, and most alone when I'm surrounded by people, and most not alone when I'm physically alone. Because at that point I can start making connections in my head to other things. Cassie comes from various places. She comes from a very close friend. And she comes from characters... I mean, going back to cultural references, the obvious place she comes from is the character of Nancy in The Craft. If everyone knows The Craft, if you don't know The Craft, then...
That's another one to go on my list.
That is it. The Craft is the most important film of the 1990s. It's the sort of the film that started, in its own way, started... the thing that ended up with Scream and the whole postmodern horror thing, but it was also the culmination of the teen movies of the 80s of John Hughes, and it's this fabulous film, and Fairuza Balk, who is the most amazing human being, plays Nancy, who is this complete loner, and they get tangled up in magic, and these four outsiders. It's got the classic scene, go and look it up, there's a great gif where they get off the bus in the middle of the countryside, and the bus driver says, "Watch out for those weirdos," and they turn around and say to him, "We are the weirdos, mister." And that is just that's the perfect sort of cinematic moment. So yeah, being alone in a crowd is certainly something I've always felt. I don't know whether it's the human condition. I think there's a lot of Sartre in here, as you will have picked up. I did a lot of Sartre, a lot of Kierkegaard when I was a student. It messed with my head completely. I think Sartre would say we're all alone, but I don't know whether he was probably universalising something quite personal again. So I don't know that we are all alone. I think there is, and I think there is more commonality. But that goes back to the stuff that Rohan deals with. For me, the commonality that we have is the boring stuff about us and the stuff that I'm slightly scared of. Mm-hmm. Because for me, community and commonality means a herd. It means the people who vote for David Cameron. By transference, it means, as someone who is disabled, it means the people who literally want the policies that will make people like me dead. So I find the idea of community and commonality terrifying, and I find the idea of aloneness completely a sense of relief and liberating.
In one of the chapters that you read, talked about self-harm and introduced the subject of suicide, and I'm just wondering how, as a writer, what kind of responsibility you feel in portraying these issues.
That's a subject that gets brought up a lot. I see behind, somewhere around there there's a book by Lionel Shriver, which I would, here it is. If ever there's anyone whose books I would throw on the fire, and I'd never throw books on a fire, it would be Lionel Shriver. I think she is the most malicious human being to occupy. No, apart from Jordan Peterson. Jordan Peterson is the most malicious human being to occupy a place in our society, but Lionel Shriver is a very close second. There is a very big movement driven by people like Lionel Shriver that the author is the author and you can say what you want. You have no responsibility to anyone but yourself, and it's this sort of author as hero, almost this Nietzschean sort of, you can say what you want because your free speech is sacrosanct. And I think that is one of the most hideous and dangerous notions that we can have.
Is the book you hate most?
We need to talk about Kevin.
I just wondered.
I would say to anyone who's thinking of reading that or who has read it, read Veronique Olmy's. It's disturbing, but it's smug. And that's the one word I'd use to describe Lionel Shriver, is smug. Read Veronique Olmy's Beside the Sea if you want something about the disturbed intergenerational relationship between mothers and children. It's the story of a mother who takes her two children to the seaside for one final trip before she kills them, because she wants to protect them from a world that she thinks is too insufferable for them to be able to cope with. And it's just magical in a way that everything we need to talk about Kevin isn't, and is trite. But I do feel a huge sense of responsibility in what I write, and I think there's something very... I get worried by writers who don't, and I think whenever I'm not happy with something I've written, it's because I've written it because I can. And there's something very dangerous about writing something because you can. And, oh, look at me, I can write something shocking now. And I think that's... We have this writer as hero narrative is a very dangerous one. And I'd like more of the writer as responsible for what they're writing and thinking about their readers. So, yes.
Very good.
Time.
Yeah, I think we're probably.
Can I just ask if anyone on the has a final question then for Dan?
If I have a final answer to give, it's buy some more of the pudding cake.
You can't.
I had the
Katrina
last slice.
Had the last piece.
Oh well, I did my job then. I sold you out of the
pudding.
Pudding cake. That's good. I feel pleased.
It was very good.
It was very good.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Can I say thank you to the two of us and thank you for all the
thank you.
Thank you. And thank you to whoever cooked the cakes and the pastadas. Thank you.